Hello and welcome to Inside Science. Yesterday mains result is out. Those people who cleared mains, congratulations to them and all the best for their interview. Those people who are writing prelims in 2020, I also wish them all the best for their prelims so that they can clear the prelims and mains as well and can come up with flying colors. Let's discuss the first issue, that is zero budget natural farming. Why it is in news? Because the Andhra Pradesh government signed a MOU with German firm KfW regarding zero budget natural farming. Zero budget natural farming aimed at encouraging natural farming in the state. They have four wheels, especially first wheel is Bijamrita, that is seed treatment. Second wheel is Jivamrita, that is the fertilizers and no pesticides. Third wheel is mulching, that is soil, straw and live. And fourth wheel is your WAPSA, that is soil moisture. We'll discuss in details in next upcoming slides. This JBNF is a method of farming where the cost of growing and harvesting plants is zero. It is not absolute zero. It is the budget is very less and that's why it is totally zero. This means that farmers need not purchase fertilizers and pesticides in order to ensure the healthy growth of crops. It is basically a natural farming technique that uses biological pesticides instead of chemical-based fertilizers. Farmers uses earthworms, cow dung, urine, that is cow urine, plants, human excreta and such biological fertilizers for a crop protection. It reduces farmers' investment. It also protects the soil from degradation. Benefits of JBNF. As both a social and environmental program, it aims to ensure that farming, particularly smallholder farming, is economically viable by enhancing farm biodiversity and ecosystem services. It reduces farmers' costs. Cow dung from local cows has proven to be a miraculous cure to revive the fertility and nutrient value of soil. Microorganisms decompose dried biomass of soil convert into ready-to-use nutrients. It requires only 10% water and 10% electricity. And it may improve the potential of crops to adapt to be and be produced for evolving climatic conditions. Let's discuss in details about the four wheels of zero-budget natural farming. The four wheels of JBNF are Jivamrita, Bijamrita, Mulching and WAPSA, says Subhash Palekar, a Padma Shri awardee who propounded this zero-budget natural farming. Jivamrita is a fermented mixture of cow dung and urine of Desi breeds. Desi breed is very, very important. No foreign breeds is required. Only Desi breed will work more. Jaggery pulses floor, water and soil from the farm bond. This isn't fertilizer, but just a source of some 500 crore microorganisms that can convert all the necessary non-available nutrients into available farm. Bijamrita is a mix of desi cow dung and urine, water, bond soil and lime that is used as a seed treatment solution prior to sowing. See, lime is used in Bijamrita only, please remember it. Mulching or covering the plants with a layer of a dried straw or fallen leaves is meant to conserve soil moisture and keep the temperature around the roots at 25 to 32 degrees Celsius, which allows the microorganisms to do their job. WAPSA or providing water to maintain the required moisture-air balance also achieves the same objectives. Government initiatives to support zero-budget natural farming. Promoting organic farming through Paramparagrat Krishi Vikas Yojana, PKVY, is there. In the revised guidelines of PKVY scheme, during the year 2018, various organic farming models like natural farming, Rishi farming, Vedic farming, cow farming, Homa farming, zero-budget natural farming, etc. came into existence. After that, a big scheme is there, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, which also supports zero-budget natural farming. A main question is like that, is zero-budget natural farming working? Discuss the benefits and challenges zero budget natural farming is facing in the Indian context and examine if it can aid doubling farmers' income in the country. Let's move to the next issue, that is I4C. That is the Indian Cybercrime Coordination Center, that is I4C, was recently inaugurated by the government. National Cyber Crime Reporting Portal has also been launched pan-India. To deal with all types of cybercrime in a comprehensive and coordinated manner, this I4C came into existence. It has seven components. This state-of-the-art center is located in New Delhi. Let's discuss about National Cybercrime Reporting Portal. It is a citizen-centric initiative which will enable citizens to report cybercrimes online, and all the complaints will be accessed by the concerned law enforcement agencies for taking action as per the law. Then the next issue is State Energy Efficiency Index 2019. The government has released the State Energy Efficiency Index 2019. The index tracks the progress of energy efficiency initiatives in states and union territories based on 97 significant indicators. Qualitative, quantitative and outcome-based indicators to assess energy efficiency initiatives, programs and outcomes in five distinct sectors like building, industry, municipalities, transport, agriculture and DISCOMs are there. Remember, the first State Energy Efficiency Preparedness Index was launched in August 1, 2018. The index is developed by Bureau of Energy Efficiency in association with Alliance for an Energy Efficiency Economy, that is AEEE. The 2019 index has included new indicators like adoption of Energy Conservation Building Code 2017, energy efficiency in MSME clusters, etc. Data collection. It will collect data with the help of state-designated agencies, example, DISCOMs. Comparison. Four group-based total primary energy suppliers, TPES, is there. What is this? The index categorizes states as front-runner, achiever, contender, and aspirant based on their efforts and achievements towards energy efficiency implementation. Front-runner category. It can be inferred that a lot more can be done at the state level to realize energy savings from energy efficiency. That is Bureau of Energy Efficiency is there. It's a government body and also a statutory body under the Ministry of Power, Government of India. So it assists in developing policies and strategies with the primary objective of reducing the energy intensity of the Indian economy. We are discussing about BEE. This BEE coordinates with designated consumers, designated agencies and other organizations to identify and utilize the existing resources and infrastructure in performing the functions assigned to it under the Energy Conservation Act 2001. So this kind of things are there, indicators are there. So after that, qualitative, quantitative, outcome based are there. You can use building code in industry, then municipalities, transport, agricultural, DISCOMs, and cross sectors are there. So the next issue is Chinese paddlefish. Recently, the Chinese paddlefish, that is also known as Cephas glaucus, has been declared extinct by Chinese scientists. It was last spotted in 2003. It was one of the largest freshwater fish. Habitats, freshwater and estuaries. What is the IUCN status? That is critically endangered. The critically endangered species are very, very important from EPSC point of view. Please remember it. Then, it was endemic to the Yangtze River, which is located in China. Including brackish water of the mouth in China, it was found in China only. It is the longest river in Asia, that is Yangtze River. The third longest river in the world and the longest river to flow entirely in the country. It rises in the northern part of the Tibetan Plateau and flows in a generally easterly direction to the East China Sea. Why it is in use? Because overfishing and habitat fragmentation is there, and due to dam building, the death of this species, that is Chinese paddlefish, is occurring. That's why it is in news. It is one of only two paddlefish species in existence. Second is the American paddlefish, whose IUCN status is vulnerable. This species is found in Mississippi River Basin in the United States. Criteria for extinction. Let's discuss about that. The red list criteria of IUCN has several categories for extinction. First is your critically endangered. The species faces a high probability of extinction. That would be considered in critically endangered. Then extinct in the wild. This means a species survives only in a captive environment. Locally extinct. This ceases to exist in a particular area but may exist in other areas. Functionally extinct. When it continues to exist, but it has too few members to reproduce meaningfully enough to ensure survival. Globally extinct, no surviving member anywhere in the world. Once declared extinct, a species is not eligible for protective measures and conservation funding. Then the next is World Hindi Day. January 10 is to promote the Hindi language all around the world is declared. It was first celebrated in 2006 to commemorate the anniversary of the first World Hindi Conference, which was held in Nagpur on January 10, 1975. World Hindi Day is also celebrated by Indian embassies located in various parts of the world. World Hindi Day is different from Hindi Divas. Please remember it. Hindi Divas and World Hindi Day, they all are different. Hindi Divas is celebrated in 14 September and World Hindi Day on January 10th. Then let's discuss something about the language Hindi. Hindi got its name from the Persian word Hind, meaning land of the Indus River. Turk invaders in the early 11th century named the language of the region Hindi, that is the language of the land of the Indus River. Then it is the official language of India, English being the other official language. Hindi is also spoken in some countries outside India, such as Mauritius, Fiji, Suriname, Guyana, Trinidad and Tobago and Nepal. Hindi in its present form emerged through different stages, during which it was known by other names. The earliest form of old Hindi was Apabhramsha. In 400 Anno Domini, Kalidas wrote a romantic play in Apabhramsha called Vikramavasyam. The modern Devanagari script came into existence in 11th century. The next issue is Indian Skimmer. The annual bird census has been commenced in the Koringa Wildlife Sanctuary and surrounding wetlands in the Godavari mangroves. In that, Indian Skimmer is found on the east coast in Andhra Pradesh. The census aims at documentation of migratory birds, resident birds. Indian Skimmer, that is also known as Rhynchops albicolis, is a water bird species. In India, the species can be sighted near the Chambal River in central India, in a few parts of Odisha and in Andhra Pradesh. In IUCN, it is in vulnerable status. Let's discuss the question which I asked in Plimps 2017. Consider the following statements. In India, the Himalayas are spread over the five states only. Himalayas are spread over Jammu, Kashmir, number one. Then after that, you can see Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand. After that, Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, etc. It's more than five states, so option one would be wrong. So you can skip option A and option D. Then Western Ghats are spread over five states only. No, Western Ghats are spread over more than five states. You can consider Tamil Nadu, number one. After that, Kerala, number two. Karnataka, number three. Goa, number four. Maharashtra, number five. Gujarat, number six. So option two would be wrong. Then Pulikat Lake is spread over two states only. It is a right answer because Pulikat is spread over Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. So option B is the correct answer. The next question which is asked in Prelim 2017 is like that. According to Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which of the following animals cannot be haunted by any person except under some provisions provided by law. Options are gharial, Indian wildlife, and wild buffalo. All are included and all cannot be haunted by any person except under some provisions provided by law, that is Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So option D would be the right answer. So let's discuss the question, CSAT question. An 8-digit number, it was asked in prelim 2019. An 8-digit number, that is this number, leaves remainder 0 when divided by 3. How many values of B are possible? There is a rule, that is when the all the if you combine all these numericals and it is divided by 3 and the remainder is 0, that can be the that can be the method. So let's solve. 4 plus 2 plus 5 plus 2 plus 7 and 4 plus 6, the answer would be 30. So obviously 30 is divided by 3. If you add, that is B, we are discussing about B. So let's say B would be 0. If B would be 0, obviously it would be divided by 30 is divided by 3. If B would be 3, then it is 33, it is divided by 3. If B would be 6, it would be divided by 3, 9. Then our 4 options are there. You can replace B with this 4 options. So answer C would be the right answer. Thank you guys. Have a nice day.